Michael is one of the engineers at Google, specializing in latency and performance. He poses some of the trickiest questions on the internal mailing lists about Selenium and WebDriver that you can ever begin to imagine. So I'm quite glad that I'm able to bring him up here on stage so he can show you the fruits of his work. Michael.
Thank you, Simon. And sorry for the nasty questions.
Difficult, not nasty.
I try to send easy, reproducible use cases.
They're good.
All right, so let me just start with a general question. Why should we care about latency and performance of web apps? Many people probably already do, but just to introduce this topic. Until late, maybe the big companies like Google and Amazon cared about every millisecond of their page load times and how long it takes to perform transactions on their websites. But smaller companies didn't really seem to think much of that. But lately, the interest is increasing, and there is a study after study that one of them, for example, is saying that every extra second of a page load time results in a 7% drop-off in the conversion rate for your customers. On mobile, the problem is actually much worse than on the desktop. While bandwidth on mobile keeps increasing, the latency doesn't seem to be decreasing. Extra requests in the critical path of your page load will just make your mobile experience that much worse. And there are other studies that, for example, show that 46% of mobile users would abandon your page if it doesn't become functional within 10 seconds. So that translates into money and makes people care more. Obviously, Google has a long-standing culture of valuing performance, and I work in that area. So with that, let's start with the simplest form of performance testing for web apps, page load performance, where you have a URL. Maybe you have some artificial cookies to bypass the login. Make sure it loads the right content, but basically it's a URL and you load it and you measure how long it takes. In the simplest form, you measure the time until the onload event fires, or in a more complicated form, maybe the page is more asynchronous and it keeps loading the content after the onload, and you need to employ more sophisticated conditions to determine when the page is done loading. Maybe you care when the above default content has finished loading, maybe you care when the content begins to be clickable, and so forth. But basically, it's a page load, right? And multiple tools exist to measure that, and there are whole companies built on that tooling. One of the open source projects that I happen to be contributing to is webpagetest.org, which lets you submit URLs, loads them in a given browser from webpagetest agent machines in several locations around the globe, and gives you various statistics about the page loads and also gives you a waterfall chart, what requests were made and what was happening within the browser with higher or lower level of detail depending on the browser. It can also simulate latency. It can inject latency through a dummy net, which is also an open source thing that you can install on Windows or Linux, and it will inject latency, bandwidth, and packet loss parameters into your link. And you need to run the thing multiple times, obviously, for it to be statistically valid to ensure that you can compare two runs and tell if the thing became slower or faster, depending on the changes that you're making. WebPageTest.org also gives you a page speed report that tells you maybe you're not gzip compressing when you should be and things like that. Now, what about interactive scenarios? Because with Web 2.0, pages are becoming more and more interactive. And for example, to order something on a website, you no longer click a submit button and wait for a whole different page to load entirely in the browser. only parts of the page refresh, right? And what that means is that there is no page load involved at that point. After you click order, there is an XHR going to the server, XML HTTP request, with some response coming back, and the page itself refreshes part of itself to reflect what's going on, right? So you usually want to test performance of those scenarios as well. And this is where Selenium comes in, WebDriver. You want to use something that you normally use for functional tests, that you normally use to drive your interactive scenarios on the page in functional testing, right? And then that lets you take your existing functional test that you write for your release process and pick a representative subset, and there you have your performance and latency tests, right? So that's the idea. Now, I wanted to expose this capability in webpagetest.org, where instead of a URL, you would submit a WebDriver program, right? And it seems offhand that it's really easy, right? You submit a WebDriver program, and you take the start time when it starts, you take the end time when it finishes, and that's your number that you track. But that's unfortunately not as trivial as that. There are tricks to it, right? But let's first get out of the way with how we embed WebDriver in web page tests. One key question is security, because it's an open service where anyone can submit their test job. Normally, WebDriver programs are Java, right, or Python or something like that. And sandboxing Java is hard. Sandboxing Python is also hard to impossible. Sandboxing JavaScript, on the other hand, is much easier, especially in Node.js with special APIs designed specifically for sandboxing. And recently, there appeared a JavaScript binding for WebDriver. So that's what I've decided to use. And what it ends up being is you write JavaScript code making WebDriver calls and submit that as your test job. And that's your test job. This is approximately how it looks in WebDriver.js. And if you Google for WebDriver.js, I think the top hit is the Selenium page with an intro to WebDriver.js. So this program gets a new instance of the driver, loads a page, and then interacts with the page. In this particular case, it does a Google search for WebDriver. And this is how the result looks, right? So what it does underneath is, so far I've implemented this only in Chrome, but it runs Chrome, and as the test runs, as the test interacts with the page, it activates the Chrome DevTools network capture events and listens for those events on the WebSocket, on the standard Chrome debug WebSocket interface that's all documented on the Chrome site. And that's basically just JSON, so it fits naturally in JavaScript and Node.js. So I capture those events, and when the test finishes, I convert this sequence of events, this JSON array, essentially, of Chrome events, into a HAR file, HTTP archive. And this is what's visualized here, and what it is just a sequence of requests. Some of them obviously go in parallel, that's how the browser is making them. Some of them are sequential, and you can see on this diagram what's going on time-wise as your test runs. So, for example, these S requests are instant search requests for some of the letters that the WebDriver script, that the WebDriver program is typing into the search box. So that's the interesting bits. And this is actually the reason, or one of the reasons, why it's not enough to just take the beginning of the WebDriver program and the end of the WebDriver program and call that the time, because what you're really interested in is some subset, some particular little bit of interaction. You want to time that specific little bit of interaction as opposed to the whole thing. Right. So why not measure around these specific WebDriver calls that, for example, type into the search box? And the reason is when you wait for something in WebDriver, underneath it's implemented as a wait loop. It checks if the element, for example, exists on the page, and if it doesn't, it sleeps for 200 milliseconds. And 200 milliseconds is way too much when we want to measure single millisecond intervals, right? Like as you see on this diagram, these are 76 milliseconds, 94 milliseconds, 115 milliseconds, 88 milliseconds. That's the absolute value, right? But the difference is as we make improvements on the page would translate into maybe 2, 3, 5 milliseconds, and that's what we want to detect. That's the granularity we want to detect. And with a 200 millisecond wait loop, there is no way that we would detect that within reasonable number of iterations. And even with a very high number of iterations, it's very dubious that we would get any useful results. So that's why, unfortunately, the naive approach doesn't work here. What can work is JavaScript self-instrumentation within the page, where in the page itself, around the points that you're interested in, you can take the JavaScript time at the beginning and at the end and subtract it, and then the page itself measures how long it took for a certain thing to happen, right? And then at the end, when the order, for example, completed, it reports back to the server, these are the times that I measured about myself. And then it all ends up in your server logs, right? And in real production, as you deploy your application, you can use that to monitor how your web app performs for the real users. And that's really the biggest advantage of doing that, right? Because it works in a real browser. It doesn't need any Selenium. It doesn't need anything. It just works. And then you just write scripts that analyze your logs. And commodity frameworks exist for this purpose. I gave a couple of examples here, but there are commercial frameworks as well. It's basically pick whichever one suits you best. But as far as test automation goes, the important aspect is that they all call home, so to speak, with these numbers. And as the test runs, since we intercept all the HTTP requests anyway to give you the chart, we can detect which one of those are the calls home, and we can parse those numbers back, right back from these requests. And so each iteration of the test gives us this set of numbers, this set of self-instrumented numbers that the page itself generated. And these become the results of the iteration. And then as you run 30, 50, 100 iterations of the test, then you can statistically aggregate and say, okay, the median time for instant search typing one letter was 50 milliseconds or 61 milliseconds, right? And then as you make an improvement, run another run of your test with 100 iterations, you can say now it was 65 milliseconds. I regressed by 3 milliseconds or whatever, right? That's the idea. Now, you could kind of do similar things even without instrumenting the page to a degree, because you have this HAR file, you have the result, this chart, right? So since you know approximately what the page is doing, you can kind of reverse engineer from the HAR, from the chart, what it was doing when it was making that request. So you can look at the HAR, for example, and say, let me take all the S requests and just take the times of those requests. Right, but that would be a custom post-processing for a particular page. It's not generic. You would have to do this for each test separately. So you kind of infer the action boundaries from your chart and then compute the times from that. That's kind of a proxy for self-instrumenting the page. But like I said, instrumenting the page not only lets you test it, but it also lets you much better monitor what's going on in real production. And in the future, there are browser specs coming up, browser standards. Right now, the browsers implement, most of the recent browsers implement navigation timings, but the other specs that are coming up are resource and user timings, where the resource timing will basically give you this chart right within the browser. There is unfortunately no browser yet that implements resource timings. And user timings will let you insert custom points into that chart that's accessible from within the browser and that the test framework can capture for you from the browser. Chrome DevTools timeline is what comes closest right now, and that's my next step. I would capture the Chrome timeline and make that available while the WebDriver test runs. And browsers are moving fast, except one big browser. So hopefully some of these specs will start showing up in the latest releases. Now, even when you instrument the page, there is a trick. Don't make WebDriver calls within one of those instrumented intervals, because making a WebDriver call into the page introduces an overhead, and that's an uncontrollable overhead. The reason is your test normally speaks to the page through a WebDriver server, which is JSON RPC over HTTP. And then the WebDriver server also makes an IPC call to, for example, a Firefox extension. Right, so that overhead is there. And especially if you wait for an element to appear, and that's within one of the instrumented intervals, you're introducing this 200 millisecond wait loop right there. So make sure you kick something off and that you begin measuring the JavaScript interval after the WebDriver call ends. Right, so you click the button through WebDriver, and then that button click initiates the measured interval on the page. And so the WebDriver overhead does not interfere with the measurement embedded on the page. Absolutely aggregate over multiple iterations, and how many is really, really dependent on what your app is, what its inherent variability is. You can get very high precision, right? You can detect 1-2 millisecond differences. But some apps require more iterations to do that. You would need to look at your 95% confidence intervals, how wide, how narrow they get. You need to basically get a feel of what the variability is before you can tell how many iterations would give you the precision that you require. Maybe you only care about 10 millisecond precision. Maybe you care to detect only 10 millisecond differences, not single millisecond differences. So you wouldn't need as many iterations. Obviously, fewer iterations means you complete your test faster. And like Christian mentioned in the previous presentation, that's another advantage of stubbing out the backends. Right? Run with fake backends, maybe use mocks or stubs or fakes, whatever is more suitable for your types of tests, but don't hit real production backends, because that tends to introduce a lot of variability into the results, and worst of all, that variability is dependent on the time of day, for example, or the day of the week. Maybe there are peak hours where the backends are slower, right? Sometimes it's hard to do that. Sometimes it's hard to actually pretend to be a backend. So what some people may do is run a single run of the test with the real backends and somehow record what the backends reply, right? And then run the next iterations of the test with the replay of the first session and only measure during those. So that's kind of another trick how the backends could be stubbed out. And that lets you achieve stable and repeatable results. And repeatable is key because as you work on improving the page, or for example, as you're looking at the regression that happened a few hours ago, that you know your test detected a few hours ago, you want to reproduce it, and maybe you want to run more runs at closer code changes to figure out which one actually caused it, right? And so the repeatability is key for these performance tests. That's all I had to say, and I wanted to leave more time for questions, or if not, we could wrap up early. Oh, and let me actually try to give a demo of how this works. Right, so here I'm starting a web page test agent, and here I have a test. Hopefully it will work. So this agent polls the web page test server for a job. Now it got the job with the script. It's starting Chrome, doing a search. And as you can see, it intercepted the Chrome network events as that's happening. And then it post-processed, and that's the JSON format HAR. And this is the test result. And it gives you more information, like, for example, what requests when went to each of the domains involved in the interaction, what content types and so forth, and then request headers, a lot of information for you to debug how fast or slow it is. All right.
Sorry, I have a question. So if you're testing an enterprise application that isn't available externally, how would you go about doing it if you can't access web page test?
So what I was talking about is just the idea, right, that you can do that. And webpagetest.org is just one of the ways to do that. And even with webpagetest.org, you can install an internal instance of it. It's an open source project that's specifically designed to be easy to install, and different companies run local instances of this. So you can totally run this within your intranet and integrate it, for example, with your continuous build, which would be totally awesome. Right? And then you have a continuous graph of what your how your latency is doing over time over changes submitted by developers, and you can catch regressions before they ever hit production. Or you can even implement a submit queue where someone could test their change before it even hits the source tree. Yes?
Is there a reason you chose to do this through Chrome rather than using a proxy?
I'm sorry, say it again?
Is there a reason you chose to do this through Chrome rather than using a proxy? Because if you used a proxy, you could potentially do it for all the browsers.
I implemented this using Chrome just because Chrome gives the timeline, the network events and the timeline. But one of the next steps is to convert all the other web page test agents so that their output is in the same format as the Chrome timeline. For the other browsers, we already produce much of the same information, and you could just, you know, go to webpagetest.org and submit any arbitrary URL that you like and look at how the report looks, right, to get a feel of what information it provides. And the only question is output it in the same JSON format. Right, so just because I showed it on Chrome doesn't mean it doesn't work on other browsers. I mean, right now it doesn't, but it's fairly straightforward to make it work with other browsers as well. And the proxy for latency tests is usually questionable. You've got to be really careful with the proxy because if you're using an HTTP proxy from the browser, it completely changes how the TCP connections work. Right? So your results could be quite different if you're going from the browser through a proxy. Forward or reverse proxy, depending on how it works. You could do that, but you have to be really careful. You have to know what you're doing. Yes?
If you're mocking out or you're doing a record and playback for the back end, then what sort of bugs are you hoping to catch with this sort of testing?
If I'm mocking out, what sort of bugs I catch? Oh, if I, I'll repeat the question because mic didn't work. If I mock out the backends, then what sort of bugs would I catch with this? I'm not aiming to catch functional bugs, right? What this is meant to catch is performance regressions within the page, right? So you could record the backend calls with or without timings, right? You could make them return instantly on replay, or you could even simulate the original time that it took during the record phase. But basically, what this thing does is it lets you catch performance slash latency regressions in the front end. And or you could catch as deep as you're willing to go with your mocks, right? So it's up to you how much of your system you instantiate for the test. You could instantiate one level of backends, or you can instantiate two levels of backends, depending on the complexity and depending on the variability. It's a trade-off in the complexity of implementing the test. Obviously, bringing up multiple components for a test is more complicated than just running a backend than just running the front-end server with the backends mocked out, than it is to run some backends with, further down, maybe with a database mocked out, right? But obviously, the more of your system you bring up, the more you exercise, and you could catch front-end latency regressions caused by second-level back-end latency regression, right? Your database query processing or post-processing could become slower, and that could translate into a user-visible regression, obviously. Practice shows that most of the time, these are due to, for example, a JavaScript code change that causes an extra reflow on the page, and the page becomes slower because of that, right? Or maybe an extra HTTP request, and especially on mobile, where the latency is high, an extra request starts killing you right away. So these are the types of things that you would normally look to catch with this type of framework. Yes.
Sorry, does the use of a content delivery network make any difference for the use of this?
The use of what? I'm sorry?
A CDN, a content delivery network for the static content, to serve the static content, of course.
So when you say CDN, I think you're implying that you would hit a live application with this, right? So obviously a CDN makes a difference because it's presumably closer to your agent machine that's actually running the browser making these requests. But the caveat with that, with or without CDN, is that if you're going over the internet and if you're hitting a live instance of your application, you will have that time of day variability pattern, that day of week variability pattern. Maybe there is a drop off on weekends, maybe it's more busy on weekdays, maybe it's more busy during US daytime hours, for example. Right, so it's not going to be nearly as repeatable as if you run in a lab environment and bring up a dedicated instance of the front-end server with the back-ends mocked out, right? Where the test itself, where you have a test code that brings up your front-end server and generates a test, sends it to web page, to your local web page, your private web page test instance, saying hit this particular server, and nothing else is exercising that server at all. And once the test is done, you kill that server, and that's the end of the test. Right? It then runs in pretty much full isolation, and that gives you repeatability that you need to actually detect regressions. Because if you run against a live instance, your latency regressed, but you don't know what caused it. There are way too many variables involved in live applications. And for real user monitoring, just use your real users. Right? Once you have that instrumentation in the page, once you have it reported to your test logs, you have many more samples than you could ever get with a test instance like that.
Thank you.
Hello. Hi to everybody. Quick question. What about caching? I mean, when we start the browser, the cache is automatically clean, which means it's repeatable. And what about your internal server caching? I mean, in general, when you run those tests, you disable the cache, or probably you try to fill all the cache and then repeat the test in both situations. Thank you.
Sure. Great question. So what about the caches? Sometimes you want to test what your performance is going to be with a warm cache, and sometimes you want to test with a cold cache. With a front-end server or with any servers, you normally care about the warm cache case, right? So you could run some iterations, depending on what your server is, to warm up the server, to let JIT do its job and to let your own caches fill up in the server, and only then do a real measurement run. right? So you do a warm-up run that you discard, and then you do a real measurement run that you don't discard. But with a browser cache, sometimes you want to have two different sets of results, one with a cold browser cache, one with a warm browser cache, right? Because the browser makes completely different requests in those cases. It does make some requests even with the warm cache, obviously, because you're, for example, making a purchase, right? But you do want to know what the user experience is like when the cache is cold versus the cache is warm, and you can control that through WebDriver calls, right? You can clear your cache whenever you like. Right, or you can let it stay warm, or you can do some runs and discard the first few samples and then take only the ones that are with the warm cache. Yes?
Tying this back to automation, is there a way to instrument or get access to web page tests API to monitor and throw alerts depending on what the results are of your automation? So for example, if your results are increasing versus decreasing, you can pick that up in the automation? Or is it a manual effort where we have to go to the web page manually to take a look at certain pages' data performance-wise?
So I'm not sure I understand the question. So
from the automation perspective, can we call into the web page test infrastructure to access some of the information that you're providing?
Yeah, so web page test itself.
And use it to whatever you want.
Right, right. Web page test itself lets you retrieve all test results, right? So you can, as you do a new run, you can retrieve the previous run and compare the numbers between the two and use whatever logic you like to tell automatically whether or not there was a regression. And if there was, you can send an email, for example.
Okay, so you know, do all that via, let's say, an API. We don't have to go to the web page manually to get all that information.
That's right. Yes. There are programmatic APIs. There is a REST API to a web page test server.
Okay.
And it's an open source, so you can test it on the public instance, and then you can use your private instance. But yeah, the idea, the holy grail kind of is to hook up a system like that to your continuous build and get automated alerts when something like that happens. Because normally these regressions are inadvertent, and very often people don't even realize that their little one-line change could cause a latency regression for the end user. All right, looks like we're finishing on time.
One more question if there is one. Thank you very much, Michael.
Okay. So I think we've got about 7 minutes until Liz Keogh gives her keynote. Now would be a really good time to stretch your legs, visit the bathroom if you need it, or just chat amongst yourselves quietly about how fascinating the conference is. Right? Or tweet about how an amazing time you've had. Or, I'll stop now.